This morning, we're going to be talking about a sermon I titled, Stay Hungry. Help me say it. Stay Hungry. Now, that doesn't sound like some people. Well, maybe because we're hungry, really. But hungry for something else. Now, I want you to please help me tell someone else beside you that looks very hungry. Tell the person, stay hungry. Now, for those that were intimidated by the people beside them, like this, I want you to turn to him and tell him, stay hungry. Everybody, turn to someone else. Now, let me show you why that fellow needs to stay hungry. I'll take my text from the book of Philippians, chapter 3, verse 13, the Living Bible version of the Bible. I want all of us to read it together, please. This is why I want you to stay hungry. One, two, go. Let's read. I am still not all I should be, but I am bringing all my energies to bear on this one thing, forgetting the past and looking forward to what lies ahead. Forgetting the past and looking forward to what lies ahead. The past's has the glory of yesterday. The past speaks of the success of yesterday. The past actually speaks of the last hour. The past speaks of everything, the good, the bad, and the ugly that we've experienced up till this minute. I am forgetting the past so that I can enter into the fullness of that which lies ahead of me. The Bible speaking concerning the heart of God with respect to you and I says that God has plans for you. Not plans of evil, but plans of a glorious future. Plans to make you prosper and flourish. Plans to make you fruitful and expand. Plans to make you multiply and walk in dominion. That's the plan of God. When you break it down, it means that those who are trusting God for a husband this year, God will still connect you to the man of your dreams. For those who are trusting God for a wife this year, God will still connect you to your wife this year. For those who are trusting God for one promotion, one visitation, one open door or the other, this God is not through with you yet. He will still make it happen for you in the name of Jesus Christ. For I know the thoughts that I have towards you, says the Spirit of the Lord. Thoughts of good, not of evil, to give you a future, and that your expected hand will not be cut short. If you agree with me, say amen. Amen. God is not through with me yet. I want you to say it. God is not through with me yet. That's why God said, forget the past, aspire for new things in the future. Forget the past because I do a new thing. The Red Sea might have blocked your way all your life. God says, that is history. I am about to part your Red Sea. I'm about to break the head of your Goliath. I'm about to make your mountain become your stepping stone. I'm about to do a new thing in your life. Forget the past. For some of us, we've kept on holding on to the past, and there is no space for the new thing. God says, empty yourself of the things I have done in the past. I'm about to do a new thing. He is God, he is not man. A man can lie, a man may not have the ability, the capacity to do what they promised to do. But God says, I am no man, I am God. I exist by myself, and I say, forget the past, forget the failures of the past. Forget the shortcomings of the past. I am introducing you to a new level. I am introducing you to a new season. On your journey of life, your weeping has come to an end. I am bringing you to a season of rejoicing. Your loneliness is coming to an end. I am bringing you to a new season of joy. Your pain has come to an end. I am healing you of all your diseases in the name of Jesus Christ. I want somebody to stand on your feet and shout a big amen. Amen. God says, I am not through with you yet. This is not all there is to me. I am bringing all to bear on one single principle, forgetting the past and aspiring to the new thing in the future. For some of us, it may be that you thought that you've accomplished so much. Nobody is comparable to you yet. But God is saying, my son, my daughter, I want you to forget the past. I am God. You can never exhaust the depth of my being. I am the El Shaddai God, the double-breasted one. The milk in me will never run dry like the milk of a suckling mother. I'm about to do a new thing in your life. It will shock you. It will baffle you. Because I had not seen, hear, had not heard what I have put together for you. It means your father, your mother, and the generation of your parents, they have never seen your kind before. God is about to unleash you to your season. God is about to unleash you into your generation. In the name of Jesus Christ. For some, it's been seasons of pain. God says, please forget the past. Let go of the past. Let go of bitterness. I know you were hurt, but bitterness will hold you. You will not have space for what I've got ahead of you. I've got plans for you. I've got plans for you, my daughter. 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 I've got plans for you, my daughter, saith the Spirit of the Lord, in the name of Jesus Christ. I want you to take your seats. I want us to watch this video clip, and I want you to remember, stay hungry.
Was identified as mentally retarded, put back from the fifth grade into the fourth grade, and stayed in that category until I got out of high school. I don't have any college training, but I met a high school teacher who one day changed my life. I was waiting on another student, and when he came in, he said to me, young man, go to the board and write what I'm about to tell you. And I said, I can't do that, sir. He said, why not? I said, I'm not one of your students. He said, it doesn't matter. Follow my directions now. I said, I can't do that, sir. He said, why not? I said, because I'm educable, mentally retarded. And he came from behind his desk and he looked at me. He said, don't ever say that again. Someone's opinion of you does not have to become your reality. And as he talked, my heart began to beat fast. Tears began to run by my eyes, and I was in the back just listening to him, because the speech he was giving, that speech was for me. And he said, Les Brown, he said, if you want to do anything worthwhile in life, you've got to be hungry. I told Mr. Washington I wanted to become a disc jockey. And so I started working to develop myself. He said, I want you to practice every day being a disc jockey. I said, but I don't have any job now. He said, it doesn't matter. He said that it's better to be prepared for an opportunity and not have one than to have an opportunity and not be prepared. And as I was working to develop myself, I applied for a job as a disc jockey, WMBM on Miami Beach. I went to a guy named Milton Butterball. I said, how you doing, Mr. Butterball? I'd like to get a job as a disc jockey. He looked at me, he said, do you have any broadcast background? I said, no, sir, I don't. You have any journalism background? I said, no, sir, I don't. He said, we don't have any jobs available. I said, yes, sir. I went back to Mr. Washington and I told him. He said, don't take it personally. He said, most people are so negative, they will have to say no 7 times before they say yes. He said, go back again. So I went back again. I said, how you doing, Mr. Butterball? My name is Les Brown. He said, I know what your name is. What do you want? I said, I'd like to know whether or not you have any jobs at disc jockey, sir. He said, didn't I just tell you yesterday we didn't have any jobs? I said, yes, sir, but I know whether or not somebody got laid off or somebody was fired, sir. He said, no one was laid off or fired. Now get on out of here. I came back the next day like I was seeing him for the first time. I said, hello, Mr. Butterball, how are you? He looked at me with rage. He said, go get me some coffee. I said, yes, sir. And I went to get him some coffee. After a while, I would get their lunch and dinner, and I would go in the control rooms and take the disc jockeys their food, and I would not leave until they would ask me to leave. One Saturday afternoon, while I was at the radio station, a guy named Rock was drinking while he was on the air. I was the only one there, looking at him through the control room windows, walking back and forth, young, ready, and hungry. Pretty soon the phone rang and it was the general manager. And I answered the phone. I said, hello? He said, Les, this is Mr. Klein. I said, I know. He said, Rock can't finish his program. I said, I know. He said, would you call one of the other DJs in? I said, yes, sir. I hung the phone up. I said, now he must be think I'm crazy. I called my mom and my girlfriend, Cassandra. I said, y'all turn up the radio and come out on the front porch. I'm about to come on the air. I waited for about 20 minutes. And I called him back. I said, Mr. Klein, I can't find nobody. He said, young boy, do you know how to work the controls? I said, yes, sir. He said, go in there and don't say nothing here. I said, yes, sir. I couldn't wait to get behind those controls. I put on an old Stevie Wonder record called Fingertips. I sat down behind that turntable. I said, look out, this is me, LB Triple P. Les Brown, your platter playing popper. There were none before me, and there will be none after me. Therefore, that makes me the one and only. Young and single and love to mingle, certified, bona fide, indubitably qualified to bring you satisfaction, a whole lot of action. Look out, baby, I'm your love man. I was hungry. I was hungry. You gotta be hungry. Begin to know that you have greatness within you. And if just one of you here begin to envision yourselves as being blessed and highly favored to reach your goals, if just one of you capture the essence of what that means, that you have greatness within you and a responsibility to manifest that greatness, that you can make your parents proud, you can make your school proud, you can touch millions of people's lives, and the world will never be the same again because you came this way. It was hard, ladies and gentlemen, coming to speak to people. And I was facing financial difficulties in my own life. I was behind on my bills and my dreams, and I'm saying to them, you can live your dream. It was hard, ladies and gentlemen. It was very difficult to pick myself up each day believing that I can do it. There were times that I doubted myself. I used to ask myself, can I do this? And something said within me, you're the one. Don't give up on your dream. By continuing to push forward, by continuing to run toward my dream, that one day I would have my own talk show. It's a long shot, ladies and gentlemen, from Liberty City, an abandoned building on a floor, never knowing my mother or father. It's a long shot. Being here with you today in this dome in Atlanta, it's a long shot. No college training, labeled, educable, mentally retarded, but I kept running toward my dream. Don't stop. Don't stop running toward your dream.
There are a few things I'd like to say this morning. Number one, if you are not hungry in life, you will never aspire for more. Hebrews chapter 12 verse 2 clearly gives us a spiritual example in Christ. It says that we do this by keeping our eyes on Jesus, the champion who initiates and perfects our faith. Because of the joy awaiting him, he endured the cross. He disregarded the shame of the cross. Now he's seated in the place of honor beside God's throne. If you are not hungry, you will never aspire for more. Number two, when you stop being hungry, for some of us, we were hungry before. But when you stop being hungry, automatically, physically, you stop aspiring for more. And when you stop aspiring for more in life, it's an indication of an internal disease. Proverbs 13:12 clearly puts it this way. He says, hope deferred makes the heart sick. If you are not hungry for greatness in life, If you are not hungry for success, you will never be great, you will never be successful. If you are not hungry to stand out, you would remain in the midst of the crowd unnoticed. If you are not hungry for excellence, you would remain in the class of mediocres in life. Number three, the unfortunate thing bringing it to the church is that we've gone the way of Demas instead of the way of Christ. Jesus, when he was on the cross, said, "It is finished. I finished my assignment. I completed the reason for which God sent me." And the Bible said, after he had said, "It is finished," he gave up the ghost. Very few people in the Bible, very few people in life can say, "I finished." That's why it said that the cemetery is the richest place on earth, because it has books that were never written. It has songs that were never sang. It had professors that never emerged. It had doctors that never became doctors. 2 Timothy chapter 4 verse 10 speaks of Demas. He says, "For Demas has deserted me, because he loves the things of this life." For too long in the church, we've deserted our calling. We've deserted Christ because of the pursuit of the things of life. We've deserted Christ. We've deserted who we are. And the word, Paul used the word desert. It means when you, a military officer that abandons his or her duty post with a plan never to return. That's the word Paul used. He said, "Demas has deserted me because he loved the things of this world." How many of us, we've abandoned our spiritual duty post in church. We've abandoned our spiritual duty post in the kingdom. Because we love the things of the world. It's only the leftover that we give God. It's only what comes convenient to us that we give God. The Bible says that Demas left because he didn't stop being a Christian. He just loved the things of the world. Oftentimes, so many of us come to church. The biggest thriving gatherings are gatherings for selfish reason in the name of Christ, using Christ in the pursuit of the things of the world, never asking ourselves, "What have I done for you, Jesus? How can my life bring glory to you this week?" If I ask 10 of us what you prayed about before this sermon, about this week and this month and this year, Maybe 1% would say, "I prayed and I asked God, God, please use me this week." Maybe just 1% or less than 1% would say, "God, I want more of you in my life." We have gone the way of Demas. It's all about the love of the things of life. Number four. Life comes with challenges. Let's stop complaining about the challenges of life as an excuse for spiritual failure. Baby, wake up. Life is real. And it comes with challenges. Whoever told you that life is easy? Oh no, they've not seen life. Stop complaining about what your dad or your mother did not give you. Life comes with its challenges. But hunger fuels the thirst, the energy, the ability and capacity to overcome the challenges of life. Bible told us that when David confronted his Goliath, they had told him that whoever kills Goliath would get to marry the most beautiful girl, the king's daughter. The Bible clearly told us, he inquired, what will be given to the man that kills this Goliath? The challenge was there, but he needed his eyes to go above the challenge. And when he found out that, well, that's worth it, he ran towards his Goliath, called on the name of his God, and brought down Goliath. He was hungry. Paul knew God. He was hungry for God. He met with Christ. And he said, I stopped conferring with flesh and blood. And he said, I forgot all. And I'm aspiring towards the new. He was a lawyer. He was an accomplished man. He was a self-made man when he encountered Christ. He became so hungry for God that everything was less than dung to him. In the 2 Timothy chapter 4, he was speaking to his spiritual son, and he gave us, you know, there are some things you share with your children that you don't share with people outside. There are pain you go through that you only tell the members of your family. Am I right, church? So this was the inside revelation of the pain of Paul. The Paul that other people saw, whose shadow was raising the dead and healing the sick. The pain that other people did not see, I'm sorry, because to them on the outside, he was a mighty man of God. To them, he was a man that had a way with words. He preached to kings. He preached to prisoners. He preached everywhere he went, to the Greeks, to the Jews. But here he was talking to his son. He said, Timothy, I urgently and solemnly plead with you. Preach the word, verse 2. Urgently at all times, not sometimes. The king's business demands haste. Preach the word, Timothy. Whenever you get the chance, in season and out of season, when it's convenient and when it is not, correct and rebuke your people when they need it. Encourage them to do right, and all the time be feeding them patiently with God's word. Timothy, stay hungry. Preach the word. Stay hungry when it's convenient and when it's not convenient. In verse 3, he said, for there's going to come a time when people will no longer be interested in listening to the truth. He said, but Timothy, please stay hungry. Preach the word, whether they seem to be listening to you or not. Don't tell them what they want to hear. Don't tell stories and fables that have no spiritual significance. Preach the word, the good news to them. Drop the seed of the word everywhere you go. Let others water it and let another come and harvest. Ultimately, let God take the glory. But Timothy, stay hungry. Preach the word. In verse 5, he said, stand strong and stand steady. Do not be afraid of suffering for the Lord. Because suffering is part of our job description. Suffering, not necessarily suffering deprivation. Suffering the shame of the gospel. Suffering inconvenience. Suffering people looking at you like you are stupid. He said, Timothy, my son, stay angry even when they do that to you, because it's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when. Verse 9. He said, Demas has left me. Please come quickly, because he loved the things of the world. Timothy, please. Some people will leave you. Some old friends will no longer stand your tenacity, your consistency. They would fall away like dried leaves. Please, Timothy, stay hungry. In verse 11, he said, there are times, Timothy, that you would be left alone. Only Luke is with me. There are times you'll be left with only one person. Possibly you've been used to having a large crowd of friends around you. Please stay hungry, even when you are left with only one person. And it even gets worse. For he tells us in verse 16, not just that one person will be with you. He said in verse 16, when I was brought before the judge, I was alone. Everybody left and abandoned and fled from me. There are times you would be alone as a believer. Encourage yourself in the Lord. Don't make it an excuse to abandon your spiritual duty post and your calling and your responsibility. Stay hungry even when you are alone. It's not enough, because life will happen. These are the realities of my pain. Under the glory, there is a story. And he said, Tychicus is gone too, for I sent him to Ephesus. At times, Timothy, you have to release your best for the sake of this gospel to be preached all over the world. You have to take some decisions. You have to at times release your wife. You have to release your husband. Don't stop them. Don't say that your child should not sing in the choir because their hours of rehearsal is too long. Release your best. Stay hungry. I sent forth Tychicus. One version of the Bible, Paul was writing about him. He said, for he is a fellow bond servant. He is a trusted fellow. He is a dependent. He's somebody I can depend on. Yet he sent him to Ephesus. Life would happen. Please stay hungry. And he said to Timothy in verse 13, please bring the books and the parchments. Because I too, not just that I'm preaching to you to stay hungry, I want to stay hungry. And the only way to stay hungry is to remain connected to God. For he is the one that fuels the fire. Bring the Bible, bring the parchments, bring the word, that I may stay connected to the word. In verse 14, he said, Timothy, part of the things I want to reveal to you is that men like Alexander the coppersmith would cause you evil and harm. Please don't abandon your dreams and your future and your calling because of people like Alexander the coppersmith. Please stay hungry. Stay focused. Stay true to your calling and your duty and your assignment. For some of us, we've abandoned our duty post because of people like Alexander the coppersmith. It looks legitimate. It looks like a real excuse. But Paul was unfolding. He removed his jacket. And he was revealing the stripes, the hurts, the pain he's had to survive and go through. He said in verse 17, but through it all, the Lord was with me. Through it all, Jesus would remain true to his covenant. He said, go in my name, make disciples of all nations, and lo, I will be with you till the end of the age. In verse 19, he said to us, say hello to Priscilla, to Aquila, to Onesiphorus. Paul told us about people like Timothy in his life. People like Artemas, people like Tychicus, Zenas the lawyer, Barnabas and Apollos. People that Paul built relationship with. Not for personal gain, but for kingdom gain. May I declare to you this morning, church, that it's important for you and I to know that for this assignment of making a difference in the kingdom of God, you need to build a team. Your relationships matter. Deliberately look for someone that you can work with which you can start possibly just reaching out to one person every week, one soul every week, fast together, pray together, have an idea. This is what we're going to do. Take them out to dinner. Pay $5, and at the end of the day, because you came spiritually charged and prepared, you would eat the food, but you would gain their soul. Because you would preach the gospel, the good news to them. And the Bible makes it clear, Jesus sent them out in twos. I believe there is a spiritual principle behind Jesus sending them out in twos. In Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verse 9 to 12, Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verse 9 to 12. He said, two are better than one because they can work together much more effectively. No wonder Jesus sent them out in twos. Look for another person to partner with. Not necessarily your child, your parent, your sibling, your husband, or your wife. Make strategic, build strategic relationships for the kingdom. Because the Bible tells us, he said, if someone is alone and falls, falling there means getting discouraged. Let me tell you, church, there are times we would get discouraged. There are times you would wonder whether this thing is working. There are times you just don't feel like waking up and preaching the gospel that day. There are times the challenges of life seem to overwhelm us. But he says when one falls, it's too bad when there is no one to help him. Because the duty of the other is to help them up. Not build friends that you are falling, you are discouraged, they would add to the discouragement. He said, two can resist an attack that would defeat one man alone. Nobody goes to war at their own expense. That's a major spiritual principle of all time. If the devil knows you are coming, he's going to come for you. But he that is in us is greater than he that is in the world. The mighty God of Israel, the mighty El Gibor, is inside of you. He rules and he reigns in the affairs of man. He speaks and it comes to pass. Nothing happens without his consent, without his permission. He is much more than able to defend you. That's why he did not just say you should go. He said you should go and I will be with you. The attacks will come and one will chase 1,000 and two will chase 10,000. Together, you would ward off any attack. Church, let's stay hungry no matter the challenges of life. no matter the consistent barrage of the onslaught from the pits of hell, let's remain hungry. Because I found out, church, that the depth of your hunger is directly proportional to the depth of your sacrifice. Maybe the reason why we've sacrificed nothing or we sacrifice so little is because we're not just really hungry for God or for the things of God or even for anything better than where we are. A hungry man will do anything for food. Have you not noticed it? That when you are extremely hungry, the food that is normally not attractive to you become attractive. Some of us believers were 1 mile long, all talk, all show, and just 1 inch deep. The depth of your hunger is directly proportional to the depth of your sacrifice. If you are deep and you are deeply hungry for God, there are some things you will do, strange things you will do for God. Things that would make people around you wonder, is it okay? The depth of your hunger would show in the size of your sacrifice. Let me flip the coin. Your sacrifice, for some of us, even coming to a midweek service is too much sacrifice. God is a hungry God. How do I know? Because when you go to the book of Genesis, the Bible says when he created Adam and Eve, number one, he put them in the garden in the cool of the day. He would come down and fellowship with them. The Bible speaking of this God, what is man that thou art mindful of him? Or the son of man that you take notice of them? God is a hungry God. He would come in the cool of the day and he would be playing with man, fellowshipping with them. Hey, Adam, what is this? And, well, I've called this one the olive tree. I've called this one the orange tree. I've called this one the mango tree. And God will be smiling and laughing, and they will be just be patting each other on the back and just be walking back and forth in the Garden of Eden. Eden, I preached before, is a place of spiritual experience. It's not a geographical location. That's why science will never discover Eden. And the Bible said that when man sinned and fell, the hunger in God, because the soul that sinned must die, he couldn't avoid, resist, or stop that. But the hunger in God showed that even as he was releasing that which is the determinate judgment due to man, he was killing a lamb. He was shedding the blood. For with the shedding of blood, there is remission of sin. He was killing a lamb and he was removing the skin and he covered them. May God cover you in the name of Jesus Christ. From head to toe, it was the hunger of this God. In John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, should not die, but have eternal life. There is only one way by which we must meet with God. The name and the man Jesus Christ is the way. He is the truth. He is the life. He is the answer to every humanity's problem. Jesus is the answer. Jesus is the answer. Jesus is the answer to the cure of cancer. Jesus is the answer to your promotion. Jesus is the answer to human depravity. Jesus is the answer. Whatever it is that is the question of life, this man, Jesus, is the answer. He's the savior of the world. He's the lifter up of our head. He's God all by himself. He's able to do exceedingly abundantly beyond all we can think of, ask for, or imagine. A genuine encounter with this God, if he's truly a hungry God, a consistent encounter with him must produce a considerable same amount of result. Hunger in you, shall we rise? He said, I look for a man in Ezekiel 22:30. Just one person. Enough of sharing the stories of the Billy Grahams and the old generations. What are the sacrifices of our generation? God is still searching for one person. He's not looking for perfect people. He makes the people he picks perfect. He's just looking for willingness. I'm not telling a story, a fable, or introducing you to a religion. I'm talking about this God. The same God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. The same God of Peter and Paul. The same God of the apostles. The same God of the Acts. The same God of Pentecost. The same God that healed the blind man. They said, who healed you? How did he heal you? He said, I don't know theology. All I know is that I was blind, but now I can see. This same God is your God. He's my God. He's your father. He's my father. And he said, I am looking for one man that would be my credible witness. One man. Jesus is calling one man. One person. In all our pursuits in life, finding fulfillment in Jesus is the foundation. For the Bible calls him the foundation. If the foundation be destroyed, what can the righteous do? You cannot build the superstructure on your life without a solid foundation. You cannot build the superstructure of your dreams without a solid foundation. You cannot build the superstructure of your business without a solid foundation. And Jesus is the cornerstone. Everything else revolves around the chief cornerstone himself. And the ultimate fulfillment in life is to experience the salvation of a soul. I want us to close our eyes and talk to God this morning as we close and go home. As we go to the world and burn for him. It's not enough to have been hungry. Please remain hungry. We must stay hungry. Through the exhilarating heights of excitement, fulfillment, accomplishment, and the valleys of pain and loneliness. We must stay hungry. Hungry as we go out, hungry as we come in. Hungry for more. Carrying the trophy of success yet asking God, what more can I do? What else can I do, Father? To you, you've surpassed everybody around you, yet you are asking God, what more, God, what else can I do? Use me. Use me, Father. I surrender to you, Lord. My trophies, I lay at your feet. My all, my home, my cars, my clothes, my education, my career, Lord, I lay at your feet. Use me. Use me. Use me. All eyes closed, please. All hearts open to this God. If you're watching online, I want you to please open up your heart wherever you may be. God is touching you. He's asking you to come home, baby. Come home. Son, come home. There's much more to you than this. Paul at the height said, there's much more to me. I am forgetting, I deliberately choose to forget the past. I empty myself that more may be poured into me. I aspire for more. Oh God. What more can we do for you, God? How would you want to use us this week? This week, this month, this year? If you can speak in the language of the Spirit, I want you to do that right away, please. All eyes closed. If you have not yet given your life to Jesus, I want you to do that exactly where you are, please. Ask Jesus, Lord Jesus, come into my heart. Come into my heart. Write my name in the book of life. I release my life to you. I surrender all to you. Lord, take me, use me, Father. Give me the power of the Holy Spirit that I may live for you for the rest of my life. I dedicate it all to you, Father. I am sorry. I am sorry. I am sorry. For all my errors and my mistakes, my negative words. Use me. Ma ingerebo shta ingrabo shte kuri viras kapo shtebo. Makunta ingerebo shtekuri viraskabo. Let fire fall, Father. Ma ikapo kunta ingerebo shtebo. Giftings and callings, Father Lord, that the enemy has stolen and deceived us into abandoning. We fan them to flame this morning in the name of Jesus Christ. Ma ikapo kunta ingerebo shtebo. Mabosh te kuri viras kapo. Mai kapo kunta ingereboshte. Mai kapo kunta ingraboshtebo. Thank you. devil.
Put devil.
Holy Ghost, release yourself. Reveal yourself unto us in a new dimension in the name of Jesus. Holy Ghost, power of God. Ma'ikapo. Jesus, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Kaposhte ingereboshte. Grabo kunta ingraboshte ingedebo. Maika ingedebo kunta ingraboshte ikapo. Mainkepo kunta ingraboshte kuri viraskapo. Fire! Maikapo kunta ingereboshte. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I want you to say these words after me to encourage those of us that have not yet met with the Lord Jesus. I want you to say, Lord Jesus, every one of us will say it together, Lord Jesus, I rededicate my life to you today. In the presence of these witnesses, I surrender to you. Spirit, soul, and body, write my name in the book of life. Grant me the power of the Holy Spirit that I may live for you for the rest of my life. I want you to be quiet. By the power in the name of Jesus, under the unction of the Holy Spirit, I send you forth in the might of God. Go and triumph. Go and step into a season of victory. May the two lift gates be opened to you. May the Red Sea part for you. May the lions fall unto you in pleasant places. May fire burn ahead of you. May glory come behind you. May God accompany you with favor. Everywhere you turn this week, may men compete to favor you. May you be fruitful in your spirit. May you be fruitful in your body. May you be fruitful in your businesses. May you be fruitful in your academics. In the name of Jesus Christ, go in this thy might, and may God be with you. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed.